Thank you. The next item of business is a debate in motion 10922 in the name of Daniel Johnson on ensuring Scotland's skills system is fit for the future. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button, and I call on Daniel Johnson to speak too and to move the motion up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The skills debate has never been more prominent nor important, and that's not just because of recent publications and reports here in Scotland. When we look globally, we see demographic changing, meaning that we need to do more with a smaller in ageing working population. Net zero in technology means that the change required in terms of people's skills and their qualifications during their working life has never been more rapid. And global economic change means that there's an emphasis on securenomics, on resilience of individual economies, and a move away from globalisation of recent decades, which means that we will need to be more self-sufficient in skills and across a number of economic areas. And that's why the skills debate is so important. So as I move the motion in my name, I would gently comment to the government that the quotes in the motion are ones from reports that they commissioned. The figures are figures that they have published. And the analysis, I would argue, is one that is actually a consensus, not just between politicians and business, but also across these benches. So I wonder why the government are seeking to amend my motion to obliterate all of those observations and comments, because I do believe consensus is possible. And I actually think we need constructive discourse, albeit critical at times. Because I think we do need to be frank in our reflections on our system here in Scotland. If we look at just raw numbers of apprenticeship completions, they are down in 22-23 compared to 15-16. Graduate apprenticeships are largely flat and small in number relative to university degrees. And the number of employers and providers providing apprenticeships is down by a fifth. We also see blockages in the system. There are some 800 apprentices who started in 2017-18 who are yet to complete. We have year 5 and 6 apprentices, which just shouldn't be possible. And that's down to blockages in assessment and the ability of those apprentices to get recognition for the skills that they have already gotten. And that's blockages in the system. And on in-work training, there are also key issues coming from employers. According to the British Chamber of Commerce, some 70% of respondents said that the skill shortages are impacting their businesses and impacting their profitability. So we have a problem both in terms of throughput in the system and real serious challenges being caused to business because of its inability to create the skills that they need. But on in-work training as well, the ONS reports that just barely over a quarter of people are in in-work training. So in terms of that flexibility, in terms of providing that training for people currently in work, it's almost not there for most workers. So it's in this context I think the Withers Review has been useful. I think it provides analysis that I think we can all agree, certainly in parts, if not all of it, and some ways forward. But what I would observe, as I don't think all of those recommendations are necessarily prioritised or on an equal basis. I think there are functional recommendations and structural ones. And I think that some of those functional ones are perhaps more important than the structural ones. But the issue we have with the government is not just that it has been largely silent in the 6 months since that report. Actually, it's been silent in some areas and overly specific in others. In the principles and priorities document, it essentially commits to a single funding structure and a consolidation of the qualifications and the frameworks, and yet it is silent on the functional issues. I would say that the points that James Withers highlights upon around flexibility, around a digital passport, around putting the vocational and skills regime on a commensurate basis with the other qualifications are critically important. And actually, embarking on costly and time-consuming structural reform could potentially get in the way of those. And I would also just note the Conservative amendment about putting the skills regime on a commensurate basis is of critical importance. And we would vote for it, but I think there's preemption involved. I would also say, even if those structural reforms were correct, I have concerns about the ability of those organisations which would be requiring to assume additional responsibilities in terms of their capacity to adopt those functions. The Scottish Funding Council has not done as much as it could do to progress graduate apprenticeships. There are huge challenges in the tertiary education sector. The SQA has a huge task ahead of it if it's going to onboard the Hayward Review and its recommendations. Whether it has the ability and capacity to assume these additional functions from the skills regime, I am not clear. And in the meantime, the overspecificity in those areas and the lack of clarity in others leaves a huge cloud over the whole system, where I think we have organisations in limbo, structures such as the SAB board essentially condemned, and SDS looking as though it's going to be dismembered, but with no real clarity as to what is going to happen. Now, I think a consensus is possible, and I would look forward to future government debates where we talk about flexibility and additional pathways, and I would urge them to do so, because that's how we build consensus and build a plan. But in conclusion, I'd just like to alight on a quote from Jimmy Reid, who in 1972 said that to unleash the latent potential of our people requires that we give them responsibility, and that the untapped resources of the North Sea are nothing compared to the untapped resources of our people. I am convinced that a mass of our people go through life without a glimmer of what they could have contributed to fellow human beings, and that is a personal tragedy, it is a social crime. Jimmy Reid was right then, but I think he's even more right now. And the failure to provide a clear plan for our skill system will continue to let down people and ensure that they don't realise their potential. Thank you much, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I'm just confirming my recollection is that Mr Johnson did move.
I moved the amendment.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I now call on Graeme Day, Minister, to speak to and to move Amendment 10922.2. Up to 5 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I genuinely welcome Labour bringing this, albeit brief, debate to you, because it gives me an opportunity to outline the work that has been undertaken in response to the Withers report thus far, ahead of giving a fuller update to Parliament, subject to the agreement at the Bureau in the coming months. Like Daniel Johnson, I welcome James Withers' report. It makes a compelling case for change, and it's an important moment in moving us towards an education and skills system which delivers for our future needs. Not long after this report, we, as Daniel Johnson highlighted, we published the purpose and principles, being clear about the outcomes that we want to see from the system in the short, medium and long term, and that we welcome the direction of travel represented by the report, and we set out some of our initial priorities for reform. However, we were also clear that we needed to take time to consider the practicalities and the implications of implementing changes, to listen to constructive and knowledgeable views. I don't therefore accept the idea that the government hasn't moved quickly. It has moved at the right pace and with purpose, and it will continue to do so. And I know that when James Withers has appeared before committees, he's welcomed the measured approach taken to considering his findings. We must be clear also that we don't start from scratch. There is much already that is positive. But Withers was a review about future needs and how we meet these. He found, I'm not going to have time, my apologies, I've got 5 minutes. He found that there is confusion and duplication in our public body landscape. But even if our current system was perfect, the world around us is changing and we can't afford to stand still. Since June, my officials have been working on the priorities set out in purpose and principles to establish the appropriate governance and approach to implementing change. And alongside that, I've engaged widely, gathering views and developing my understanding of the challenges organisations are facing and how that's impacting on their staff and ultimately the learners. These conversations have helped me be clearer on the steps needed to bring about improvement and the prioritisation of these. And this process will continue as we narrow in on the potential routes to reform. The programme for government already commits us to updating Parliament and our plans for reform of the public body landscape and our response to Withers. But I've been engaging directly also with opposition parliamentarians, meeting, for example, Liam Kerr and Willie Rennie to hear their views. And next week, I'll meet with Daniel Johnson as well. I hope these interactions demonstrate my commitment to the widest possible engagement and to trying to find the consensus that Daniel Johnson referred to. On net zero, it's clear that there's a step change that's needed in our workforce if we're to deliver on our ambitions and meet our emissions reduction targets. This is one of the key reasons why we accept the recommendation around skill planning moving to the Scottish Government, so there is greater coherence and impetus behind that objective. We need to ensure that every part of our education and skill system can match people towards the available opportunities and that we can put in place the relevant pathways. We're doing what we can here. the government has already committed £500 million over 10 years to our Just Transition Fund, including over £10 million for skills-related interventions. It's been deeply disappointing the UK government hasn't matched that investment. Presiding officer, I've also heard loud and clear the concerns expressed by James Withers and echoed by others about funding, recognising that the complexity and multiple streams are confusing and inefficient. That's why, as part of the programme for government, we've committed to leading development of new funding models to simplify the funding landscape and ensure we're getting maximum return on our investment. This will be all the more important given that we find ourselves in the most challenging financial situation since devolution. To be clear, neither Withers nor Purpose or Principles was commissioned because of budgetary pressure or to respond to public sector reform, but that is a context we are now in. The Labour motion didn't mention the join-up with wider education reform, but it's crucial to see the reviews as part of one package of reform, and therefore right that they are considered and presented to Parliament in that manner. What we need here is a simpler, more efficient system, more easily understood by learners and users, that equips young people to make the right choices for themselves and make the fullest possible contribution to our society and our economy. The reforms being taken forward and the steps we're taking on implementing them will move us closer to that ambition. And we'll continue to move forward in close collaboration with colleges, universities, trade unions, industry and other stakeholders. And let me add to that list the staff in the potentially impacted agencies. Because not only is that the right thing to do, to engage with them as I've done, it has, for example, already fed into our thinking on the provision of a national career service and how we help make apprenticeships more accessible to SMEs. And I move the amendment in my name, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and to move Amendment 10922.1. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by welcoming this debate on the future of the Scottish Skills Agenda, although it is a pity it's taking place in opposition time and is such a short debate. There are a wide range of issues that need to be addressed in relation to the question of skills, including funding for universities and colleges, funding for apprenticeship schemes, and the future of the agency landscape. So I think it's disappointing that the Scottish Government has not allowed time for a full debate on these vital issues, which are key to the recovery of our economy. And having listened to the Minister and indeed Mr Johnson, I suspect there's more common ground on this than actually ground where we would disagree. And I think a full debate on these issues would be very welcome. And I would also say that we would agree with every word of the Labour motion. When I read it, I didn't realise that it was lifted from Scottish Government publications. That doesn't stop me from endorsing the wording of the motion. And as Mr Johnson said, we have a short addition to it, which I hope members will look sympathetically on. The motion does not specifically mention the Withers review, but I believe, as others have said, we all owe a debt of gratitude to James Withers for the work he did in preparing his independent review of the skills delivery landscape, which was published back in May. And Daniel Johnson calls on the Scottish Government to formally respond to this by the end of the year. That's a call I would endorse. There are issues, really important issues here, where we do need to make swift progress on to meet the demands of industry. Just to give one example, yesterday I met the Civil Engineering Contractors Association, who raised with me their concern about the difficulties their member companies have in securing appropriate funding for apprenticeships. Construction is an area that needs to attract a large number of younger people to fill vacancies being left by an ageing workforce. It is an industry with highly attractive pay and conditions, and yet without public support, many smaller employers and medium-sized employers are struggling to be able to afford to take on apprentices. The Flexible Workforce Development Fund, run through Skills Development Scotland, is supposed to provide funding for these apprenticeships, but many employers find it in practice extremely difficult to be able to access that funding. And similar points were made by the Construction Industry Training Board in their briefing for this debate. And they also highlight the important issues around the transition to net zero that we all support, where we will need to see retraining of those who are currently employed in construction and other trades if we are to meet those challenges. And that's going to require a stepped increase in the support available. My amendment today mentions the issue of parity of esteem, which James Withers highlighted in his own report. And when he appeared at the Economy Committee last month, he told us, in relation to the funding of higher and further education and training more generally, that apprenticeships have been the poor relation. And he told us he would like to see universities having the freedom to utilise the core funding they get from the Funding Council to deliver degrees either through full-time study or through apprenticeships. We should not see these routes as separate and distinct, but both should be part of the same mainstream. And his view was that that of the total amount sent in Scotland on skills of £3.2 billion, there needed to be greater flexibility to use that funding, including to fund apprenticeships. In that regard, we need much greater clarity on the apprenticeship levy. I hear from UK-wide employers that south of the border, there's much more transparency around accessing the apprenticeship levy and how employers can get their hands on that money. In Scotland, that levy, our share of that levy, goes into the block grant, and it's then very difficult to identify how much of that money actually goes into funding apprenticeships. And not surprisingly, many businesses feel frustrated. They're having to pay this levy, but they're not able to get anything back in return. So the Scottish Government do need to be clear and transparent about what happens to these funds. Presiding Officer, this is a matter the Scottish Government are able to address in their upcoming budget. We need clarity around the apprenticeship levy and where exactly that money goes and why it is not currently reaching the front line. That is the point made in my amendment for this debate, which I have pleasure in moving, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. And I now call on Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
We'll support the Labour motion today, but I do want to give credit to the Minister and also to the Withers Review. I think he's engaged in a positive fashion, and I think the omens are good for a good policy in the future. But the recent record in the government on skills has not been a positive one. The last minister, to be frank, just didn't seem to be too interested in the whole area. We've been waiting for over 5 years for this skills landscape reform, and the minister only acted after he was criticised by Audit Scotland for the lack of leadership. And although we have the Withers Review, we don't have the formal official response from the government. So it could be even longer from that initial start point where the landscape review was supposed to be undertaken before we actually get any change. And the world is changing fast. We're going through a new green industrial revolution. So while we're waiting a long time for the reforms to come, the world is moving on, and I fear for the consequences of that. It would be wrong not to mention colleges today, especially following the Fraser of Allender report this week, where it talked about graduates from colleges boosting the economy by £52 billion over their working life. And Shona Struthers was right this week when she said that the report quantifies the huge return on investment from Scottish colleges. But this is the crucial bit. She was puzzled that there isn't a decisive move to invest more and gain more. In fact, investment is falling sharply. In other words, the college sector delivers billions and could deliver more, but the government is cutting millions. And the symptoms are strikes, the threat of compulsory redundancies, and the loss of opportunity for potential students. So we do need to invest in the college sector if we're going to get the proper return that is promised. But there is much in the Withers Review that I think we should commend. I think it brings clarity and clear roles and responsibilities. It brings clarity for employers and training providers and students, and it gives intelligent control over how the money is spent. For students, the new career service, which I know the Minister thinks is a central piece of the Withers Review, led by the newly reformed Skills Development Scotland, making sure that it covers not just those who are choosing a non-university career trajectory, but also those who are going into higher education, so everybody gets the best advice. For employers, better, clear advice from a single source through Scottish Enterprise. I think that is long overdue, but also a more systematic involvement of employers in the planning of skills. For everyone, a single source of funding, bringing together education and skills, national and regional planning to set out immediate and future skill needs, parity of esteem, utilising much more effectively the SCQF framework. But there are questions around the role of the employers group SAB, which I am meeting tomorrow, but the devil will be in the detail of subsequent decisions on policy and funding. Simplification can sometimes mean a lack of sophistication, with some losing out. For example, the implication, he doesn't quite state it, but the implication in the Withers Review is that the Flexible Workforce Development Fund should end and brought under the main central funding. But some employers, as Murdo Fraser has highlighted, may lose out as a result of that simplification and the lack of sophistication. So we need to make sure that the new system does take account all of those needs. And bringing together funding for higher education, further education and skills will mean little if there isn't a transfer of funds between those different functions. But making that transfer will be fought fiercely by those defending already shrinking budgets. So we need to address the simplification on that front too. These are difficult matters, but we must have these discussions and in with much more time if these reformed skills landscape is going to be fit for the future.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We now move to the open debate and speeches of up to 4 minutes. I call Colin Smith to be followed by Kevin Stewart. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, if you want an illustration of what has been a lack of leadership, a lack of urgency from government in facing up to and tackling the skill shortages we face today and which will become even more profound in the future, it is the treatment of Scotland's colleges, as Willie Rennie has already highlighted. A week never passes when I don't speak to local businesses who tell me about the acute labour and skill shortages they face, businesses who are desperate to recruit, desperate to upskill their staff, desperate to take on apprenticeships. Yet when I speak to my local college in Dumfries and Galloway, they tell me their Skills Development Scotland apprenticeship contract for 2023-24 has been cut by 13%. At a time when demand for apprenticeships is at peak levels, crucial areas for the local economy like construction and engineering now have waiting lists for apprenticeship places at that college. It is, Presiding Officer, the economics of the madhouse. It was bad enough that the budget agreed in February meant a real terms cut of £51 million for colleges that would have led to a 10% reduction in activity levels at that college in Dumfries. But the decision to axe a further £26 million has meant brutal cuts in colleges with courses axed, not because of a lack of ambition from our colleges, not because of a lack of demand from students or employers, but because of a lack of priority on skills from the government. And where is the SNP's green fair work agenda when those cuts mean colleges are now embarking on compulsory redundancies? Where is the fair work agenda when college staff are having to take industrial action to fight for a fair deal for last year, never mind for this year? Presiding Officer, I've lost track of the number of times ministers have stood up in this chamber and told us there's no strike action in their NHS because of their intervention, that their action settled the teachers' dispute. But when it comes to college pay, the perception of college staff is that government ministers have been posted missing. Now, I don't know if the minister's been on a picket line speaking to college workers. I've been on many. If he has been, he would know that none of them want to be on strike. Their demands are not unreasonable. What is unreasonable is the real terms pay cut they've been offered. What's unreasonable is that inadequate pay offer is being funded on the backs of sacking staff. And what is unreasonable is a lack of intervention from the minister to broker a deal. Presiding Officer, that says all you need to know about the lack of priority the government is given to our colleges. Our colleges are the powerhouse of our economy and skills at every single stage of the learning journey. New qualifications for school leavers, upskilling, retraining those already in the workplace. James Withers' review of the skills delivery landscape described that role as absolutely pivotal. But it is a role that is being held back by government cuts, by funding bodies that don't properly recognise the additional cost of delivering college courses in rural areas where skills shortages are often the most acute. And it's a role that is being suffocated by that cluttered landscape it operates in. So when the government does get round to eventually responding to the Withers report, I hope they'll heed the calls for stronger leadership and direction from government, and crucially, the recommendations that would see far more focus on our colleges as a key anchor institution driving that skills agenda forward. But I want to end in a final plea to the Minister to take a more interventionist role in trying to broker that deal between college staff and colleges so they can get back to the job of delivering the figures that Willie Rennie highlighted that really are strengthening Scotland's economy.
Thank you. And I call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Pam Gosell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The rollout of the Scottish Government's 10-year Just Transition Fund is in its first years. And this substantial structural change that Labour is calling for in their motion is already underway. And it's vital that there is a focus on being smarter about skills delivery by ensuring skills delivery matches industry needs. And that is exactly what is happening in the North East. In year one, the Just Transition Fund has supported initiatives right across our region. £1 million was awarded to the National Energy Skills Accelerator for its pilot energy transition skills project. NESA is a partnership between Robert Gordon University, the University of Aberdeen, and North East Scotland College. The Energy Transition Skills Project is aimed at determining the exact skills required to meet the needs of the net zero energy transition from now until 2030, and to develop targeted training, upskilling and reskilling for people impacted by redundancy or transferring from oil and gas, with a focus, of course, in retaining jobs in the North East. The focus is on matching skills development to the exact needs of low-carbon industries. And in the words of Professor Underhill, NESA Chair and University of Aberdeen's Director of Energy Transition, this work will help prepare the education pipeline for the anticipated surge in key skills requirements and lay the foundations for upskilling and reskilling to benefit sustainable energy careers for existing workers and future generations. £5 million has also been awarded to APITO to deliver an energy skills passport. The energy skills passport will streamline the transfer of skills and address the lack of recognition of cross-sector skills. And this will allow oil and gas workers to prove that they have the recognised qualifications and training needed to access new clean energy jobs. The passport is also key to streamlining reskilling by identifying specific skills gaps and targeting training to those specific gaps, which will both allow workers to be reskilled faster and allow more workers to be reskilled with the same resources. Now, Pat Rafferty, Unite Scottish Secretary, speaking on behalf of the STUC, said the passport will help identify to all stakeholders where there are skills gaps and shortages, which can shape appropriate policy responses so that we can deliver a just transition and net zero economy. Now, I recognise that is work that is in progress, and I recognise that there is some stickiness around about the passport, and I hope that ministers will be able to ensure that those difficulties become unstuck and that that works the way that it should. Skills delivery cannot be restricted to reskilling today's workers. It's vital that tomorrow's workers who are currently in our schools and colleges come into the workplace with the skills for the future. And then again, in the North East, that is happening with the Just Transition Fund, with the Energy Transition Zones partnership with North East College, developing the Advanced Manufacturing Skills Hub in Alton's in Aberdeen, and working in schools throughout our region. Presiding Officer, with such excellent work, early work, by the Just Transition Fund, it's vital that both Labour and the Tories in Westminster commit to matching the SNP's £500 million Just Transition Fund. It might be a little bit late, but it's not too late. And better late than never. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call Pam Gosell to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm delighted to be able to contribute to this debate on the importance of Scotland's skills landscape to its future economy, and I will be supporting the amendment in the name of my colleague Murdo Fraser. As someone who took a very unconventional journey through the various stages of the education system, I have long been an advocate of the idea that one size does not fit all, and that different people suit different pathways. For example, I have two boys. One of my sons have took the more traditional route through higher education, university, and is now a doctor. My other son is training to be a mechanic through an apprenticeship. But it's disappointing that there is still so much more work to do to achieve parity of esteem between different pathways such as these. For many young people, an apprenticeship is an ideal way to learn on the job, and is a type of learning supported by over 12,000 employers in Scotland. But as it stands, demand for apprenticeships is outstripping supply. Earlier this year, the Scottish Government left both training providers and young learners in limbo because of delays to apprenticeship funding. This is despite confirmation from the Scottish Training Federation that demand for apprenticeship places has never been higher. But this failure to provide enough apprenticeship places is undermining the crucial role that they have to play in Scotland's future skills landscape. Presiding Officer, a report released this week from the Fraser of Allender Institute provides a fresh look at how important colleges will be to Scotland's economic future. It highlights that highly skilled college graduates benefit the Scottish economy by around £8 billion in total. The study also found that just a single year of college graduates has the potential to increase labour productivity by more than 0.3%. And these are just two of many benefits our college sector can offer our economy. But this is a sector that has struggled for years due to continued underinvestment. I would also like to highlight that there is also a significant gender divide within apprenticeships, with female apprentices entering lower paid work on average compared to the male counterparts. I hope that the Minister will be able to set out what he is doing to close this gap in his closing remarks. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Fraser of Allender Institute put it best this week when they said, colleges sit at the forefront of skilling up the nation through its diverse and extensive selection of further and higher education courses. Without taking full advantage of this pathway, Scotland cannot have a skills system that is fit for the future. Our colleges are capable of delivering the skills our country needs, and the onus now sits with the Scottish Government to deliver the funding for apprenticeship places that is clearly needed. I will today fully support Labour's motion, and I hope the Chamber can support the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser, which calls for the Government to ensure that everyone who wants to pursue an apprenticeship is able to do so.
Thank you. And I call Martin Whitfield to be followed by John Mason.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to follow Pam Gosal in respect of this debate, because I think she highlights something that is so important, that there are unconventional routes through education. There is not one system that works for all of our young people, or indeed our people in work, or indeed our older people, and that the need for flexibility sits at the very heart of the reasoning behind this debate today. And I would echo Colin Smith's contribution and others about the importance of colleges and the need to see, if not government intervention, an urging from government, a facilitation from government to settle the dispute that is in front of us. Because all of this about skills talks to something that is so important to Scotland, and that is the picture about the public finance. The Scottish Government's own medium-term financial strategy published in May estimates a funding shortfall of £1 billion in 2024-25, and that will rise to £1.9 billion by 2027 and 28. The updated fiscal framework may have reduced this headline figure, but as we've heard, the Fraser of Allender Institute estimates that the First Minister's announcement on council tax will come in at some £417 million. And it's in this context that we need a government that is focused on economic growth and creating more well-paid jobs. And how that is achieved is by the dissemination of skills, the reskilling, the newly skilled, and pointing to skills for our young people and those already in employment, so that we can take an increased tax take to fund the public services on which we all rely. And I welcome the Minister's commitment to matching particularly young people to skills, but perhaps could extend that to matching people who are needing reskilling to the correct and proper skilling. And I welcome the announcement of the simplification of funding streams, because that in itself has created a landscape in which our SMEs and other companies find it almost impossible to proceed through an apprenticeship, a scheme that so many of those that run our SMEs themselves went through when they were younger. And addressing the skills shortage in our economy is the fundamental strategy that we have for growth. It is a good government that would be serious about growing the economy. It would be a good government that is serious about addressing the skills shortages. But we have a situation in Scotland where many sectors are not planned for at all, particularly integral to our growth, particularly with regard to our digital skills. There is a widening of that gap, and there is no bridging that I see that is going to cover that in the near or foreseeable future. And as a result, do we have the ability to develop a resilient domestic supply chain? We don't. Look at the capital projects that are being held back by staff shortages. And can I welcome the briefing paper from the CITB, where they point out that the lack of construction skills plan for Scotland, with a clear overview of existing delivery arrangements for upskilling and reskilling and specific funding programmes, is a significant omission to the skills delivery landscape. Time is short here, but it is worth pointing out again. The independent review reported that the skills delivery has lacked clear leadership and direction, and there is an opportunity from the Minister to change that. But that failure lies in a succession of government ministers who've neglected that responsibility, who have not been a good government. And we are now paying this price. The question of why it's taken so long for the government to respond to the report is pertinent, because time spent waiting for this response is time wasted for our young people and those who are seeking change. We've heard about the benefits in the North East, but we need to see that across the whole of Scotland. We have a falling birth rate and an ageing population here. Our way round it is to support those people who are coming into work, who are in work, to reskill. And that is the way that we can build an economy that works for all of us. I'm grateful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call John Mason to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you very much. And I thank Labour as well for bringing this debate today. The motion calls for structural change, and that has been committed to, I believe. However, I always have some reservations about too much emphasis on structures. With the cost involved, there are other factors at play here as well as structures. One factor we also need to take cognizance of is the emphasis we as a society place on university education. Absolutely, we should enable every person for whom university is the right choice to get there without fees or other barriers. However, university is not the right route for everyone, as other speakers have said today. And we need to get that message across to our young people and to their families and to wider society. Modern apprenticeships certainly are the right route for many, and that route will often open up a career and a way of earning more money as well as more satisfaction than university would have. Society needs a mixture of people with a mixture of skills. In my own case, I decided to train as an accountant and I needed to go to university to do that. But I think currently we find some young people who decide to go to university without much idea of what job they will do at the end of the course. And that is disappointing both for them and for us as a society. So I would just argue that we need to get the balance right between young people studying a subject that they would like to do on the one hand, with what longer-term career they are looking to have as well. I thought James Withers' comments on parity of esteem were excellent. And as he says, the way we talk about different pathways is fundamental to achieving parity of esteem. He goes on to say, briefly, yes?
Minister.
Sorry, officer. Can I offer John Mason the reassurance that the very points he is making are perfectly valid and are forming a lot of our thinking around the National Career Service to address these very issues?
John Mason.
Well, that's great, and I'm reassured by that. James Withers goes on to say, different pathways are simply different, not better, not worse, just different. We want to, quote, consign to the dustbin the outdated view that studying at university is somehow a better kind of success. But at the same time, we should be proud of our university sector, there are also multiple potential pathways available. Again, learning happens in schools, colleges, universities, workplaces, and elsewhere. We need more of a single integrated system. I agree. I think it is unfortunate that Labour's motion refers to skill shortages but does not mention Brexit. With the best will in the world, neither Scotland nor the UK will ever produce exactly the goods and services we need. We always need to import and export. And in the same way, however good our education and training system is, a flexible international labour market, as the EU provides, allows our people to take up opportunities in other countries and allows others to come and take up opportunities here. The government is taking time to consider the Withers Review recommendations, and I think that is right. He makes 15 recommendations, and some are more radical than others. Specifically, recommendation 5 proposes a single national funding body, and I do certainly warm to that proposal. Scotland is a relatively small country, and we should be able to run things in a simpler fashion compared to larger bureaucratic countries. So my inherent feeling would be to support such a simplification. My only real concern would be to ensure that such a body would operate on the parity of esteem principle and would not, say, favour universities over colleges and modern apprenticeships. There's an important point, too, just in passing, that we should recognise the skills of migrants. Concerning the Conservative amendment, I welcome their support for parity of esteem, but I also note their point about shortage of public funding. That strikes me as slightly ironic. Firstly, because this is the party which wants lower taxes, and that would inevitably mean a greater shortage of public funding. I'm sorry, I don't have time to give in. And as usual, they do not suggest where the money should come from. To finish on a positive note, 93% of school leavers are going into positive destinations. So while we always want to improve those destinations going forward, there are lots of positives in the present Scottish system, and we should not be afraid of celebrating these. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful to the opportunity to speak in this debate. Can I thank the Labour Party for bringing such an important issue to the Chamber, and in my view, an issue which has been neglected by the Scottish Government. And let's face it, Deputy Presiding Officer, the SNP Government have been in power for 16 years. That is practically a whole generation of potential skills development that has been far, far, far too far down the list of SNP priorities. But, Presiding Officer, we do have such an opportunity here, especially in the green economy and in the blue economy and in the rural economy. We talk about the need for a just transition away from oil and gas. Now, the SNP Greens will troll out mandatory world-leading targets, then pat themselves on the back and head off to the wine bar. Job done. Now, I've always said, that this Parliament voted for renewable targets that we set last term, but with the understanding that a route map to achieve these targets would be brought forward. Case in question, Minister Patrick Harvey brings forward a bill to retrofit 1 million homes with heat pumps by 2030. What a great idea. But who's going to fit them? Who's going to service them, let alone who will pay for them, given the need to be fitted to homes with good insulation and underfloor heating? Sorry, Minister.
Minister.
Brian Whittle makes points about delivery on the emissions target. Why is it the Conservatives oppose every single measure that comes forward in this Parliament to deliver on those targets?
Brian Whittle.
I think if the Minister had actually been listening, I said it was a great idea. So I But as I said to them, who will fit them? Who will service them? Let alone who will pay for them? The construction industry told us they will need an extra 22,500 tradespeople and engineers by 2028 if they have any chance of hitting that government target. That would mean they'd have to be in training now. What an incredible opportunity for our pupils, or for those looking to transition from the oil and gas sector into the renewable sector. Yet this obvious first step to meet this world-leading target of weaving a green economy into our education system has been overlooked by the Minister. Not one single person in the industry that I have heard from believes for one second that this target will be hit. Empty rhetoric, empty words, and of course, blaming everyone else for their failures. Presiding Officer, we have 13% of our working age population economically inactive. the majority of whom are inactive due to poor health. In fact, poor health, not just being economically inactive, is the biggest drag in our economy. And the way to deal with this huge issue is through investment in our education system. Education, in my view, has always been the solution to health and welfare. Giving pupils confidence and resilience and aspiration by showing them what the renewable economy could offer them and what they in turn could do for the green economy and for Scotland. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, what an opportunity we can offer for those in education, in our schools, in our colleges, and for those transitioning from the oil and gas sector, in engineering, in tradespeople, in our rural economy, in our blue economy. The Scottish education system should be at the forefront of delivery of global net zero ambitions. And remember this, Presiding Officer, some of those who will pick up the baton and run with it, these ambitions by 2045 are in primary school or even in preschool. We should be enthusing them and encouraging them into these sectors. We should be ensuring that there is an understanding of the huge variety of skills required for our future generations. But unfortunately, we have a government who cannot join up these dots, a government who cannot make the connection between setting targets and delivering a roadmap. If we get it right, our Scottish health, our welfare, our justice and our economy will benefit hugely. But if we continue along the road of this Scottish Government have been taking us for the last 16 years, we will slide further behind the curve and we should be leading. Scotland deserves much better, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Bob Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our economy is changing. Indeed, it has to change. Living in the midst of a climate emergency, as we are, it has perhaps never been clearer that business as usual, whatever the sector or industry, is not an option. And of course, underpinning that economic transformation must be a skilled and supported workforce who come from and sustain resilient, cooperative and compassionate communities. So education and skills development of our workforce and communities are vital to us to achieving our ambitions across all aspects of our lives. I want to thank James Withers for the work he undertook for the independent review of the skills delivery landscape in Scotland. This wide-ranging review and its recommendations are challenging and thought-provoking. I appreciated the session with him that we had in the Economy and Fair Work Committee recently, and I know these conversations will be ongoing. As we've already heard, the Withers report warrants a dedicated and detailed response in its own right, and this is forthcoming. The structural and operational recommendations speak to important issues, the need for more strategic working, for policy coherence, for empowerment of regional and local partners and workforces. There are, of course, specific skills needed to ensure we deliver the just transition we want to see. Skills in energy, of course, but also in things like affordable net zero housing. The construction workforce needed for retrofits is a nice example of the urgent need for targeted government intervention, as we've just heard. And we must work with industry to ensure we have the in-work learning opportunities our workforces will need. One further comment on policy coherence, maybe strategy coherence too. We won't meet our legal climate targets, nor will we achieve the just transition or creation of the clean green economy we want if the different components of work don't join up. Agencies and industry are calling for this too, so I'm hopeful that the Green Industrial Strategy will provide that coherence alongside the updated Climate Emergency Skills Action and Just Transition plans. We need to identify skills balancing opportunities and accelerate investment in skills too, as we've heard from others already. And of course, the Fair Work Agenda, highlighted this afternoon by Colin Smith, must be central to that coherence. Presiding Officer, I want to use my remaining time to highlight just one other important area that we cannot overlook as we create the strategic landscape for our future economy, that of gender inequalities and occupational segregation. I'm grateful to close the gap for the conversations I've had with them about this. Occupational segregation is all too apparent in our labour market. Women are concentrated in low-paid, undervalued and increasingly precarious jobs. Jobs that are often low-carbon jobs, but are overlooked when we talk about net zero skills and jobs. The skills system in Scotland reinforces patterns of occupational segregation, as does the modern apprenticeships scheme. Women are vastly underrepresented within the energy sector and in green jobs more widely. And sectoral skills shortages are correlated with occupational segregation. Such labour market rigidity must not be sustained. As we look to reform the skills landscape in Scotland, I hope that we will take seriously the opportunity to get rid of gendered patterns of skills acquisition and employment so that we do not further entrench occupational segregation and gender inequalities across our different workforces in different sectors. In closing, Presiding Officer, I appeal to the Minister, to all in this chamber, that we take seriously the calls not to be gender blind as we undertake reform of our skills landscape, that we take seriously the calls for genuine political leadership for this work to happen and happen at pace, and that we heed the calls for strategic and policy coherence within and across sectors. If we get this right, it will make so much easier our ambitions to create and sustain an economy that cares and provides for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Bob Doris, final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This afternoon's debate has been fascinating. There's actually been a fair degree of consensus, well, in parts anyway. In the first instance, we all accept that there's a clear case for change regarding how we further develop and improve our skills landscape. It is, of course, right that we navigate any change, that we take the time to fully engage with industry, trade unions and educational institutions. Some of those in this place would wish to see us, or the Scottish Government, act more swiftly to consider and implement recommendations, would also likely be amongst the first to complain, and rightly so, Presiding Officer, if there was not full engagement with industry, unions and the education sector. So let us do so, yes, timidly, but meaningfully, and let's get any required changes right. COVID has been devastating, Presiding Officer. However, having checked the Skills Development Scotland website, it showed there has been 25,447 modern apprenticeship starts from April 2022 through to March 2023, and that modern apprenticeship starts are now 91% returned to pre-pandemic levels. That's positive. And as SDS says, it's showing employer demand for critical skills. The challenge is, of course, to ensure we deliver the right skills and training at the right time to support our businesses and our workforce. That's what the review is all about. The skills review is crucial. However, Skills Development Scotland also confirms that figures show the number of apprentices in training currently across the country, despite some of the doom and gloom we've heard today, at its highest ever level, at around 39,000. It is important that we ensure the needs of our school leavers and workforce more generally are met when we take forward changes to the skills landscape. And we have solid foundations to build on, with 93% of school leavers sustaining positive destinations, with many in education, training and employment. It is also encouraging that the percentage share of individuals who start a modern apprenticeship with a declared disability, of care experience or coming from an ethnic minority community has increased. Although I do know members have raised concerns over gender segregation and the need for more women in those roles. And the crucial role that apprenticeships have to play as a pathway into highly skilled employment for those from our most deprived communities is clear, with the largest share of starts, 24%, where individuals come from 20% of our most deprived backgrounds. Now, the review talks about significant funds in the system already, often been fragmented and not always used as effectively as it could be. And I note one example was colleges, who often have to balance their sustainability between a mix of core funding via credits and the bolt-on funding such as through National Transition Training Funds and the Young Persons Guarantee. So I was very interested in recommendation 5 to establish a new style national funding body to have responsibility for administering and overseeing the delivery of all publicly funded post-school learning and training provision. Really interesting idea. That would have a clear line of sight between ministerial priorities and policies and public funding. And it also links to recommendation 6, redesign the process for how funding of all learning and training provision is to be taken forward. In the very limited time I have left, Presiding Officer, in that context, we must look at the position of colleges. They have a hugely tight financial predicament at present. They are making redundancies. They need investment and sustainability. If recommendation 5 and 6 mean anything, it must deliver for Scotland's college sector.
Thank you. And we move to winding up. And I call on Liam Kerr, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I begin by echoing Murdo Fraser's opening lament that in closing a debate as important as one entitled Ensuring Scotland's Skills System is Fit for the Future and Hit the Main Points, I've got a mere 4 minutes. Because as many have said this afternoon, this is perhaps the key issue that we must address if we are to sort out Scotland's economy and give our young and not so young people the skills to succeed, not only in the Scotland of the future, but in the Scotland of the present. And that's why, whilst I commend Labour for using their opposition debate time to lay a sensible motion, which we shall support, I find it nothing short of appalling that despite Audit Scotland's conclusion that urgent action was needed on skills from the Scottish Government nearly 2 years ago, and despite the Withers Review's conclusion that skills delivery has lacked clear leadership and direction, and despite the substantial structural change that is recommended to ensure the skills system is fit for the future, the Scottish Government has failed to bring such a debate itself and give us proper debate time, just as Daniel Johnson pointed out, it has been largely silent since the Withers Review. You see, I think that what we've heard this afternoon is that we all agree that Scotland urgently needs a vision for a flexible and responsive skills delivery system that is fit for the future. But we do not get to that by slashing around 150,000 college places since 2007, especially when, as Willie Rennie said, the Fraser of Allender Institute issues a report saying college graduates will benefit the Scottish economy by around £52 billion over their working lives. We don't get there by seriously underfunding our further education sector, then, as Colin Smith said, whipping a further £26 million away from them. We don't get there by failing to be transparent around funding from the apprenticeship levy, and as Pam Gosell highlighted, delaying funding to training providers and learners, or making it difficult to access flexible workforce development funding, as Murdo Fraser said, or by simply accepting a situation where there are 350 fewer science teachers, 300 fewer maths teachers, and 65 fewer physics teachers in 2022 than there were in 2008. What we have heard, however, is that what will help are things like parity of esteem between further education, higher education, and apprenticeships, as demanded by the Conservative amendment. What will help are increasing and properly funding the number of apprenticeships alongside clarity and transparency around the levy. What will help is offering every adult access to skills funding through a right to retrain programme, and taking note on the recommendations in Withers, such as ending the duplication of bodies and the creation of a targeted skills development board which directs funding and opportunities to industries and areas where there is a workforce shortfall. And as Martin Whitfield said, more urgency, more action. And one key point on what will help was made by Brian Whittle. We've got so many opportunities in things like the green, blue and rural economies, but these are often stymied due firstly to an obsession with headline-grabbing targets which are not underpinned by a delivery plan, and secondly, a highly concerning tendency to silo thinking instead of the cross-cutting vision and oversight that is required. And for these reasons, Parliament should vote for the motion in Daniel Johnson's name and also the amendment in Murdo Fraser's. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Richard Lockhead. Up to 4 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think one area we can all agree on is that this is a very important debate, and I very much welcome the fact the Labour Party brought this forward as their choice of topic. And the importance of this was brought home to me just before I came to Parliament for this debate, where I visited the National Robotarium at Heriot Watt University, when I was admiring that amazing facility, state-of-the-art facility, it's going to prepare Scotland for the rest of the 21st century, looking at the role of robotics and AI, and it just reminded me how quickly our society, our economy, and the world is changing. And that's why this debate is so, so important. And I think Scotland's got two key windows of opportunity here. We've got the net zero stroke energy transition, which will bring great jobs and wealth to this country. We've also got the high growth sectors and the tech sectors, which is the other massive window of opportunity. So getting the skills right for the future is absolutely vital. We are at a crossroads. If we take the right roads, we've got big prizes to win and secure for our country and our country's future, and particularly the future of our young people. And that's why the Scottish Government, of course, commissioned the Withers review into Scotland's skills system, because now is the time to do that and fix it. Over the next few years, we have to get this right if we're going to capture those prizes of the future. Now, the reviews that we've undertaken have highlighted there's widespread confusion about current public body roles and the responsibilities, and of course recommends reform, which of course is what we're debating today and what the Scottish Government is now considering. And we've accepted the basis of many of these recommendations made by James Withers. We've of course have got to take the right time to get this right because it's so important, and I welcomed, of course, as I'm sure you all did, the Minister's commitment to work to build consensus across the Chamber and speak to members as well. And what that means in the face of this fast pace and fast change in the Scottish economy and the global economy is that we need a skills system and an education system that's agile, that's flexible, where our colleges, our universities in particular, are able to upskill, reskill and deliver lifelong learning in a genuine, meaningful way, because they say that whilst people today may have three or four jobs in their lifetime, they're now saying that tomorrow it will be three or four careers in your lifetime. And this is why we need a system that's agile and fit for purpose.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for the Minister giving up some of his time. Would he also agree then that it's really, really important that in a marketing sense we ensure that pupils at school understand the opportunities that will be available in future economies?
Minister.
Well, yes, of course, that's really important. We've got to talk about what's happening in our schools as well as the further and higher education system, the wider skills landscape at the moment. And I absolutely believe in parity of esteem. As someone who left school and then went to college and then went into work and did part-time college while I was at work, then left my job to go to university, got my degree and went back into the workplace, I know there is no wrong path, as we say in the campaigns to persuade the young people. There is parity of esteem. And that, of course, has got to be an outcome of the changing landscape and the policies going forward in this country and people's impression of what they can get out of the skills system and the education system in Scotland as well. I want to pick up on a couple of quick issues that members mentioned. Firstly, Pam Gosselaar and Maggie Chapman mentioned the whole debate around gender issues and particularly in apprenticeships. And I should just point out the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board created the Gender Commission to develop recommendations that offer real practical solutions to help address the gender imbalance across all of our apprenticeships, and recommendations were given to the government which are now being taken forward and considered, and that issue is obviously quite important. And also, Brian Whittle and some others said, we're not training people for the net zero industries of the future, we're not doing that. There's lots happening in our colleges and universities just now, lots happening. And earlier this year, Scottish Renewables found that almost 22,000 students in Scotland are taking courses relating to renewable energy, up more than by 70%. 70% increase in 2019. We've got colleges training people to install air source heat pumps and other equipment as well. So there's a lot happening. I hope we can work together, build consensus, deliver a skills system that delivers for Scotland and our young people and captures these massive economic prizes for the nation.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to wind up the debate. Up to 5 minutes, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to close for Labour today. We brought today's debate because the stakes to get skills right have never been higher, and my colleagues Daniel Johnson, Martin Whitfield and Colin Smith highlighted just how high. Yawning skills gaps, shortages of apprentices, families struggling to make ends meet, a declining economy and public services starved of cash. And whilst I recognise both ministers' offer to engage widely on reform, I'm yet to be convinced that the pace of change is sufficient or that the breadth of the vision needed to create and spread opportunity for all is there. Presiding Officer, spreading this opportunity starts with education. When education is valued and nourished, it creates and spreads opportunity all through life. In school, when we learn about the world around us, in college and university where we live to work, where we learn to live and work in it, and even in the workplace or our community where we learn to apply it. The opportunities education can bring are endless and the skills it builds are crucial. And I welcome the Minister's comments and others, including Brian Whittle's and others, that the entire education system matters in skills, but I remain disappointed that, at least until now, it seems to be undervalued by this government. It has been deprioritised. Cuts are swathing. Inequality is holding back progress. Nowhere is this seen more obviously, as we've heard, than in science, technology, engineering and maths. skills in which are widely recognised to be the accelerating forces for future economic growth and to meet the challenges of tomorrow. It's also consequently where the well-paid jobs of the future lie. To create a Scotland where opportunity is for all, we have to smash every glass and class ceiling in the way of pursuing those skills for the future. Economics, the law, and yes, Jimmy Reid, as we've heard, all tell us why opportunity must do that. Yet, Presiding Officer, as Bob Doris, Maggie Chapman, Pam Gosal and others have colleagues have noted, women and girls are underrepresented in these subjects and sectors and are routinely denied opportunities to build skills in them. There are many reasons for this, but they start in the early years of children's lives, where the first real exposure to the building blocks of skills they'll need, take an interest in and then excel at, happen. And as the Institute of Engineering and Technology reports, not focusing on STEM from an early age limits choices later in life too, including for girls, and the data shows it. We know that girls are far more likely to study hires in art and design, French, fashion, food tech and childcare, and boys are more likely to study computing science, physics, engineering and graphic communication. And we know that gender stereotypes continue into the workplace too, as colleagues have said. 60% of people working in care are women, yet women only represent 30% of the STEM workforce. And of that, 70% leave, and only 12% of the remaining women reach managerial levels. We have to use every opportunity to expose all young people to the broadest of skills, including in STEM, if we're to address skill shortages in key sectors and ensure we take everyone with us. We also have to address... Is it possible to have time back?
No.
OK, I'll take a very brief intervention.
Paul Sweeney.
With our time, would she agree that the creation of the BE Systems Applied Shipbuilding Skills Academy in Glasgow is a key example of how we can promote STEM to across genders, across class, across different groups in their communities?
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I thank my colleague Paul Sweeney for that intervention, and I absolutely agree with that, and it is a shining example of what we can do when we innovate to address skill shortages in Scotland. We also have to address the fact that exposure to science or maths or computing for anyone often doesn't happen until a child picks them for their qualifications at age 16. Those opportunities should be open to them much earlier and aplenty throughout their school career. We must be innovative in how we do this. We need to teach children that maths is useful and introduce them to real-life examples of science and technology early and often. Too often, schools in richer areas can offer this more than others. So we must spread that opportunity if we're to build the skills of the future, and we have to smash that class ceiling. If we want more pupils to access opportunities, including in STEM subjects, we also need a teaching workforce that's equipped to do that. But we're not there yet, as Liam Kerr has noted. There are far few teachers in STEM, far too few teachers in STEM. Numbers are plateauing and targets are missed. The government must urgently address this. We also have to create parity of esteem in vocational and academic skills too, including through apprenticeships, as Murdo Fraser has pointed out, which is why we will also support the Conservative amendment today. And lastly, Presiding Officer, as Colin Smith, Willie Rennie and others have noted, further education is crucial. That's why it is disappointing that this government has left them crying out for help and struggling for cash. They're not just key for skills development, they're key for addressing inequality too. We have to change the way we think about education skills and skills, the decisions we make about them and the money we allocate to it. We can't keep saying they matter and do more of the same. The government has a lot of work to do and it needs to prioritise it. This matters. It's about skills, jobs and the economy, yes, but it's about spreading opportunity too. That's why we brought this debate today. We have to smash the class glass and step ceilings to do it so that aspiration and opportunity is available to all. That's what's possible, that's what's needed, and crucially, Presiding Officer, that's what a Labour government's mission will be, and I urge the SNP government to match that ambition so that Scotland can once again be a land of opportunity for all.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. That concludes the debate on ensuring Scotland's skills system is fit for the future. It's now time to move on to the next item of business.